Hello, it's Keith here, and this is lesson 34 of the platform specific series of my 6502 assembly tutorials. We're going to be looking at hardware sprites this week on the NES. We're going to learn how to get some sprites onto the screen, and we'll be able to make some little graphics. We're going to be drawing a simple crosshair. The example we're going to be doing is 16 by 16 pixels, but because the NES sprites are only 8 by 8, we're going to have to combine four together to make our image. So let's go over to the source code and let's see it in action. Okay, if I just run it on the NES here, and you can see we've got our little crosshair just here. Now let's go back to our example information here and we'll just see some more details of this. So the first thing we need to understand is the definition for the tiles. Now the tile definition for the sprites is actually the same as the regular bitmap information, which makes things nice and easy for us. If you want to make a valid bitmap format, of course you can use my Hackett Sprite Editor. It's a slightly different example I've got here, but it does work the same. And if you just go to 6502 and NES Famicom, you can just use Save All Bitmap and it will split up the 16 by 16 sprite in the way that you need for today's example. So that's how you can get your bitmap data. And then the other thing you need to worry about is actually getting the definition for the position and the selected bitmaps that will make up the sprite into the sprite table. Now the way we do this is with two PPU ports. The PPU is the graphics hardware on the NES. So we use 2003 to select the sprite address. There are 256 bytes in total that make up the sprite information, and there's 4 bytes per sprite, so it's pretty straightforward to work out. The sprite information is basically consecutive. So first we will take our sprite number, multiply it by 4, select the sprite address, and then we will write the sprite data to 2004 here, and the first byte will be the Y position. The second byte will be the tile number of the sprite. Remember, we'll be using 4 sprites in total to make that 16 by 16 sprite. Then we've got a few attributes, V flip, H flip. We've got a background priority, whether it's in front of the tile map or behind it. And then we've got a palette. We can select from 4 different palettes here. And then, of course, finally, we've got the X position here. Okay, so let's go over to our source code and let's just see how that actually works in practice then. Okay, so we're going to want to transfer our sprite information to somewhere in memory. Now we used tiles 128 onwards for our Chibico character. That's the little mascot you can see here. So we're going to need to use something else for the sprites. So we're going to use 192, and that is effectively VRAM address C00 on the NES here. And so we're loading that destination in here. We're loading the source, the sprite start here, the size, we're calculating just here. And we're using the define tiles function, which we've used in the past. We use this for our tile map data, and that will transfer into video RAM. Now, if you don't know how to do that, please see the tile map example, because that will show you how that works. I'm not going to go over it again today. So that's how we get our bitmap data for our tile into video RAM. Then it comes to setting the actual 4 sprites that are going to make up the 16 by 16 sprite information. So I'm using some zero page entries here. This is going to be the X position. It's actually 16-bit because some of the systems need 16-bit, but we don't actually need it for this example. But we're loading an X position here. We're loading hexadecimal 40 as the XY position. We're selecting our palette and storing that in zero page entry ZL, which is a symbol, of course. We're selecting tile 192 as the first one, storing it in ZE. And then we're selecting hardware sprite number 0 and running a function called setHardwareSprite, which will set the top left part of our image. Now, we're going to need to use 4 different sprites, 4 different hardware sprites to make up our image. And because each hardware sprite number can only appear one time on the screen, we're going to use number 0 here, number 1 here, number 2 here, and number 3 here to make up the full image. And you can see that just here. We're moving the X position 8 pixels to the right, and then showing hardware sprite number 1 with consecutive tile, tile number 193. We're moving back the X position and moving down the screen and doing another hardware sprite here for 194, and finally sprite number 3 for 195. So that's how we're building up that image here, which you can see just here, and we can quite easily prove that to you. If I just take out the last one of these and run again, well, you can see we're now missing a part of our image here. So you can see we are actually using 4 hardware sprites there to do that. So all of the dirty work of setting up the sprite information is in this setHardwareSprite function, and that's what we're going to have a quick look at now. So where is it? Well, it's just down here. Now, with so many things, the hardware sprites on the NES you can only access during V-Blank. So what we're going to do here is we're going to wait for V-Blank and then just start transferring the data. If you were going to do things in a bit more of an advanced way, what you would want to do is you would actually want to have some kind of routine in the interrupt handler that would do this during V-Blank there, and you'd want to have a buffer somewhere in your normal memory until the V-Blank starts. But that's beyond the scope of this. We're just looking at a very simple example today. So we're simply going to use our wait frame routine, which we've used in the past, which waits for the V-Blank interrupt to start and then transfers the data. So there's 256 bytes in the tile definitions, and there's 4 bytes per sprite, and they're all consecutive. So we're first multiplying the hardware sprite number in the accumulator by 4, and that will allow us to select the memory address we want to write to in the sprite table. We do that by saving that number to 2003. Then we just need to transfer the 4 bytes of information that define the tile's position and the sprite number we want to show, and we're just doing that there. We're just transferring each one of them to 2004 consecutively in the correct order. YPOS, tile number, attributes, and XPOS here. Once we've done that, as every time when we write to video RAM, it messes up the scroll position. So we're just running a routine here to reset the scroll position just there. And that's really all it takes for this very simple example. As I say, if you wanted to make it a bit better, you'd probably want to do this in the V-Blank. And we have covered that before in the tile map example. And also in my Grime 6502, we looked at how to do that kind of thing. So you can take a look at those if you want to see a more advanced way of doing it. But basically, you just need to have an interrupt handler that will handle it for you. So there we go. We've had a quick look at how to define a sprite on the NES there. You can see it's not too difficult. The limit, of course, is 64 sprites on the screen, and we've just got to make sure we do it in V-Blank. As I said, you can get my AcroSprite editor, of course, along with today's source code if you want to have a go. It's all on my website in the sources 7-zip. So please go ahead and have a go with that if you want to do so. I hope you found this interesting. I hope you'll enjoy having a go with the NES hardware sprites. If you've enjoyed this lesson, please like and subscribe and have a look around my YouTube channel, because I've got lots of programming tutorials on other systems, both 6502 based and also other CPUs. So there's probably some other stuff that might interest you. Whatever you do though, I hope you enjoy programming the NES. I hope you enjoy programming in general. Thanks for watching today, and goodbye.